This podcast is now available on iTunes, Stitcher, Google Play, and more. Please leave a written review on whatever app you get this podcast from. Spoiler alert! When this podcast talks about the television series Game of Thrones, it talks in the context of the most recently aired episode. And when it talks about George R. Martin's A Song of Ice and Fire series, it talks in the context of the most recently released book. You've been warned.
Dedicated to HBO's Game of Thrones and George R. R. Martin's A Song of Ice and Fire series, you're listening to Game of Thrones, Matt's audio blog. And now, here's your host, Matt Murdock.
And we're back. Finally back. Can you believe it? We're back. We're starting season 5. And for those of you who managed to stick through all of my delays and all of that stuff and have stayed subscribed, thank you so much for doing so. Welcome back to Matt's audio blog. Game of Thrones style, we're starting season 5. With Season 5, Episode 1, The Wars to Come, written by the showrunners Benioff and Weiss, and directed by Michael Slovis. And man, it has been a journey this semester for me, being back in school, also getting sick again, all these kinds of things that just kept stacking on top of each other. And then the recordings of these podcasts. I was originally supposed to have Stephanie on this podcast, and then it was going to be Stephanie and Susan. And then Stephanie was sick, and then Susan and I recorded, and then the recording that Susan and I did got completely trashed somehow by my computer. So here I am, last minute, once again, trying to just record a podcast to keep up. But we have many guests this semester. Listen to me, I'm still in school mode. We have many guests this season coming in. We have Holly, we have Bubba. We have Susan, we have Stephanie, we have Kelly. So there's lots of great guests coming, just not for this particular podcast and not for episode 506, Unbowed, Unbent, Unbroken either. Simply because that was the episode that broke me. It broke this camel's back. That was the straw. So I needed to handle this one by myself, so that I could yell and scream and not offend anybody while I did it. And, you know, you may not want to listen to that podcast because I'm not going to have some very nice things to say about the showrunners or whatever. But I'm not quitting the show this time, at least, like I did back with Podcast Winterfell. I stopped watching the show after the 6th episode of this season. That's not the case. I've been able to go back and watch all of the episodes this time around. Man, I'm rambling, and all you want to do is talk about Season 5, Episode 1, The Wars to Come. So let me just tell you a little bit about the podcast first. Matt's audio blog, mattsaudioblog.com. That's where you find all of the back episodes of this podcast. You can also find all kinds of social media links, contact links, and podcast app links. Please, if you haven't done so, and you're listening to this podcast on a podcast app that allows you to leave a written review, please do so. That's the only way that I'm going to have enough listeners to where the feedback, we're going to get a good variety of feedback for season 8 when it comes back in April of 2018. Listen to me, I'm just not all together here. I'm trying to rush through this. April of 2019 is when Game of Thrones, the final season, returns. The teaser trailer looks great. I mean, it doesn't have any real significance unless you want to just try and imagine the fact that it means something about the Lannisters getting eaten by dragonfire, but the dragons all dying due to the White Walkers. That's really all that I could make out of it if there's any kind of symbolism to it at all. Not a, really a need to talk about that. Listen to me. I'm still babbling on. Mattsaudioblog.com. Mattsaudioblog.com. All of the back episodes, please leave a written review on whatever podcast app that you're using if it allows it to do so. What else? You need to contact me with your feedback for this particular season. And if that includes berating me for my reaction to season 5, episode 6, Unbowed, Unbent, Unbroken, I welcome that. I'll take it. I'll read it all. You just need to get it into me by January 19th of 2019, and it will be included in our next feedback podcast, which will happen between season 5 and season 6. You submit feedback by sending emails to mattsaudioblog@gmail.com. That's mattsaudioblog@gmail.com. Or you can tweet to mattsgotblog on Twitter, mattsgotblog on Twitter. Sorry for all of the rambling up front. I'll try and organize myself a little better as we talk about Season 5, Episode 1, The Wars to Come, written by the showrunners Benioff and Weiss, directed by Michael Slovis. Our discussion of the story is next. Okay, so as we start talking about Season 5, we like to organize things around here into certain little pigeonholes, or at least I do, because that's part of my podcasting OCD in a lot of ways. I have a way that I like to organize things, and that is things that are on the surface, meaning that they aren't necessarily more than a superficial thing, but they can still affect you, like an emotional thing or even a thematic thing. I think can be an on-the-surface kind of thing. It's not really a deep thought. Maybe it is for some people. For me, themes are just like sometimes they work, sometimes they don't. But then we go into the three big things, and those are big points in the episode that have a lasting effect on the rest of the series or really encapsulate the main point of a character or that type of thing. And then we have tidbits, which are things that are a little bit more important than on the surface, but not quite as important as the three big things. So that's the way I divide things up. If you're new to the podcast, if you're a longtime listener, then man, you're probably tired of hearing me talk about that. So let's get into talking about things on the surface. And
on the surface,
I guess we can go thematic or title-wise. Right off the bat, the title is The Wars to Come. Well, what exact wars are coming now that we can watch this on a rewatch? Because I mean, people might say, oh, the Battle of the Bastards. Well, technically that's a battle. Or maybe even this season, the Battle of Winterfell. Well, technically that's a battle. That's not really a war. And really, the war with Stannis is still part of the War of the Five Kings, right? Even though Joffrey claimed himself the winner of the War of the Five Kings at his own wedding back in season 4 before he died, he ended up dying before Stannis does, right? The War of the Five Kings is really still technically going on because Stannis now has a new army. So I don't quite get where the wars that are to come. There is, of course, a big war with Dany coming, I suppose. You can consider that one of the wars. There is, of course, the war with the White Walkers coming. So that's technically two, so that's technically plural. So I guess that's the way we're supposed to look at that. It also comes from a piece of dialogue, I believe, between Tyrion and Varys, or something to that effect. So I've covered that. Now, as I said, for on the surface, I like to get more on the emotional side of things. For me personally. And this time around, and the first time around when we were watching this in season 5, I had already read A Dance with Dragons, right? I had already read A Feast for Crows. So there are certain things that were happening in those particular books that I was looking for in this particular episode, especially around Mance Rayder. It doesn't appear that any of that's going to have happened now, obviously, because both of the characters that were involved in that are now dead on the show. So I don't think there's any way that they could recreate that scenario. But I was so busy looking for some kind of trick about Mance's death that I honestly did not get to feel the full impact of Mance's actual death until I rewatched the episode this time around. And those moments are super intense. I didn't realize that at the time when I first watched this, again, because the book reader in me was expecting something slightly different. So I was just waiting and waiting, and then I was kind of like, oh, what happened? You know, so I didn't get to feel the super intensity of the emotion of losing Mance this time around. And man, did Kieran Hines sell it. What a great performance of a man who's just scared to literal death, you know? I mean, and the whole impact of John firing the arrow. This time around, just the shots were so intense. The music was so intense. And I'll be talking about that a little bit in the musical analysis section at the end of the podcast. But I just really intensely emotional this time around for me. That it wasn't the first time around, again, because as a book reader, I was expecting something slightly different. Or just some kind of hint as to how it was going to be different. Now we don't have to worry about that. And I'm not going to tell you what the storyline was exactly, just in case you want to read the books. But, yeah. So, there you go. What else on the surface here? Pentos is in the credits again. It's on the map again. It's been a very long time since we've seen Pentos on the map. I loved seeing it again. Here's the thing that I can't remember, and I'm too lazy to go back to the very first episode. I think that might be the only time that we ever saw Pentos before this was in the very first episode of the series when Viserys and Dany were there with Illyrio. This time around, of course, Tyrion and Varys are there at Illyrio's place. But the thing is, I can't remember if the pop-up map is the same or not. So if you want to go back and look for me and let me know, I'd appreciate that. mattsaudioblog@gmail.com. Otherwise, I'm not going to worry about it. But it was like, oh, Pentos. We haven't seen Pentos since like the very first episode of the whole series. At least I think that's the case. I don't recall seeing Pentos any other time because they always just went to Vase Dothrak or the Dothraki Sea or whatever after that. What else? Well, Brienne, of course, on an emotional side. She doesn't have anyone left to serve. And I felt really bad for Pod because it almost seems like he's kind of like this victim of small business downsizing, right? It's like, oh, I don't have a need for a servant anymore because I don't have a mission. And I love the way that Podrick sticks with her also. That's great. I love that relationship in a lot of ways. Even though Brienne is very much Don Quixote, she's very much fighting windmills most of the time. And then, you know, when she could be of great help, like to Sansa later on in this season, she instead goes and chops Stannis' head off, which, of course, he does deserve. I will say that. But I guess that's all I have for on the surface this time around. I limited my notes a little bit because I had, Susan and Stephanie to talk to about this episode. So this episode may be fairly short. Of course, I'm rambling a lot, so that means it'll probably be even longer than normal than when I start to ramble. But let's move on to our three big things.
Three big things.
So my first big thing is in regards to Jaime and Cersei and their relationship. We know by the end of season 7 where this ends up, it seems that Cersei has drawn a line in the sand and Jaime has turned around and walked the other way. But this, I'll even say in season 4 that Cersei was starting to use guilt, not just her wares, because it's obvious in season 4 that she's aware that she can use Jaime's love for her to try and get him to do things like try to kill Tyrion. But it's also obvious that Cersei doesn't really feel about Jaime the same way that Jaime feels about her. And it takes up until season 7, I think, for Jaime to even come close to realizing that. Even though I don't think that he's stopped loving her. I just think that he realizes that she doesn't love him the way that he loves her because she was essentially going to have the mountain kill him. But guilt is the big thing that Cersei will now use. Now our daddy is dead. I told you to kill Tyrion. Our dad would still be alive if you had killed Tyrion instead of letting him go. That's the kind of thing that Cersei is going to use. And she's, of course, going to use that to manipulate Jaime. When this whole threat about Myrcella comes up in an episode or so, as far as Dorne goes, she is expecting Jaime to say, yeah, I'll go get her. In fact, she's hoping that he does, because she has a bunch of stuff that she needs to do around the small council. Getting rid of Mace Tyrell, sending him off to Braavos, that kind of thing. And in order to be able to get that kind of stuff done, she needs Jaime out of the way. Just like in season 6, she needs Jaime out of the way so that she can blow up the Sept. Because Jaime's not going to let that happen. Especially when you consider the way Jaime felt about Wildfire with the Mad King. Now, would Jaime kill Cersei? Nah, I don't think so. But he would definitely find some way to stop her. So she needs more and more for Jaime just to not be there. Right? So this is the kind of the guilt thing that she's starting to set up, that Jaime will definitely fall for because he's totally in love with her. And it's going to end up badly for poor Jaime in terms of his love by the end of season 7, for sure. Now, most of us fans are like, yay, Jaime woke up. But, you know, it's still heartbreaking for the poor guy. He loves his sister. Can't help who you love, right? The other thing about this, of course, is the flashback. And I've got lots more to talk about with the flashback in the questions section, because there are some things that we can ask. But the flashback does reveal a lot more about the motivations that Cersei has about Margaery. Or eventually, maybe she'll think about that prophecy when she's thinking about Dany too. But it seems much more obvious that she's thinking about Margaery when a younger queen will come to take her place, because Margaery is essentially crowned queen. Whereas Daenerys is claiming to be queen, but she's still just a Khaleesi in a lot of ways. The other thing that this tells, though, and the way that she will react in terms of when the Dorne send Myrcella's necklace with a snake in a snake's mouth, you know, it does tell you how much she really cares about Myrcella and why she is so fearful once that snake is delivered, right? Because she literally threw Tyrion down on the ground up against the steps when she found out that he was sending Myrcella away to Dorne. We saw her beg Oberyn Martell for the safety of her girl. And that wasn't just a manipulation to get him to vote against Tyrion in the trial. I think that was genuine. And now we see where it all comes from. She's lost Joffrey to Tyrion, or so she thinks. She's losing Myrcella because of Tyrion, or so she thinks. And it's all due to this prophecy. Her children are being taken away from her and killed by this prophecy, and that's exactly what she's seeing. But I've got questions about all of this more in the question section, which will be coming up next. Let's move on to my second big thing, which is Melisandre's interest in Jon Snow continues. Remember at the end of season 4 where they were burning the dead and Jon Snow all of a sudden looked across the burning pyres and there's Melisandre staring at him? Well, there's a few more questions that come along now, and there's a great deal of discomfort in Jon's eyes as Melisandre's more or less sizing him up. On a hindsight, it's easy to say, oh yeah, it was the detection of King's blood, because Jon is a Targaryen. He's a true heir to the Iron Throne. But there seems to be this difference in the way she wants to use his king's blood as opposed to the way she wants to use, say, Gendry's King's blood. Remember, she was more than willing to burn Gendry up. She only seduced him so that she could get some blood to demonstrate that his blood was powerful. And it did work. So far, it's killed Joffrey and Robb. Hasn't killed Balon yet. Won't kill Balon till season 6, if you even believe that that's the case. However, with Jon, she asks questions like, are you a virgin? And then when he says no, she says, good. Does she want to make a smoke baby with him? Because later on in this season, she's ready to get it on with him. She's definitely ready to get it on with him. And that could, of course, made all of the difference in the Battle of Winterfell. But this is the beginning of her fascination with Jon. And, of course, it's because she loses faith in Stannis, maybe partially due to this fascination with Jon, when she returns to Castle Black after Jon has been stabbed. It's a good thing that she's there because she's learned from Thoros something about saying some words, and she's able to sprinkle some water and say some words and bring Jon back. So, the fact that Melisandre is recognizing something in Jon now is a good thing. Even though, ultimately, Melisandre can never be considered a good thing because her character is just so tragic and so flawed and so mistaken so many times. But it is a good thing that she has interest in Jon Snow, because that's what ends up saving him, or bringing him back, not really saving him. My third big thing, of course, is that Littlefinger is continuing to try and figure out different ways to get power in there. He's playing the game. And I love it when Lord Royce says that basically Robin doesn't have any gifts. And Littlefinger says he has the gift of a great name. But that's just after he read this scroll, which obviously now tells you that it was about marrying Ramsay to Sansa. But he's looking at Sansa when he says the gift of a great name. And he is using Sansa's name to help get him into alliance with the Boltons. He's the Vale now. He is essentially the Vale. The Boltons are the North. And remember what he says in a couple of episodes to Roose. He says, the last time the Warden of the North and the Warden of the East got together, they threw over a dynasty, right? So there's a lot of game playing going on here as well. But the thing that's kind of disappointing is that now, in the wake of season 7, it's like, this is kind of the last big play that Littlefinger makes. This is his last little quest for power. I mean, in this particular season, he does go down and he talks to Cersei about, well, let Boltons and Stannis fight it out, and I'll just clean up afterwards, and I'll become Warden of the North. You know, that's what he's really looking for. And I think he even wants Sansa to be his wife after that happens. But in actuality, once Jon is made the king in the North, you know, and Sansa has kind of lost the true power, she's still the Lady of Winterfell, obviously. But Littlefinger's real quest for the big thing kind of comes to an end after this season. There's really nothing else except just to be Sansa's helper and ultimately Sansa's victim. Thank goodness. I mean, what a creep. I'm glad to see him go. But it's kind of the last big play that Littlefinger makes. And there's still a whole season. Well, technically two seasons, but it feels more like a season and a half since season 7 was only 7 episodes. It seems all for naught. On a rewatch, while this was a very fascinating thing to see play out for a lot of people, it didn't really mean all that much. It means a lot for Sansa. That's why it is a big thing. I mean, obviously, this is leading up to that Unbowed, Unbent, Unbroken episode that I'm going to just be raving on. So it is a big thing. It just seems a shame that we have this great villain who's no longer with us, who won't be throwing his fingers in anywhere. I guess you don't have time when you've only got 6 episodes left to have a side character throwing his fingers in somewhere. But I'm not sure if that's how real life works. Anyway, as I said, in one of my big things about Cersei, I do have some questions.
Questions.
And with those questions, let's just start once again with this whole thing. Now, book readers, we know, we call this scene, this flashback scene. First flashback, by the way, in Game of Thrones. Bran, of course, is having flashbacks because he's peering back into time, but that's much later. We don't get that until season 6. But this is the very first flashback that we've really had in Game of Thrones. And book readers, we've all read Feast for Crows, so we call this scene, if you TV viewers were confused why we were saying Maggie the Frog, that's what the witch's name is in the books. It's not clear that this is supposed to be the Maggie the Frog. It is funny, I'll just say this right off the top, that just like Cersei said the comment about Tyrion's nose at the beginning of season 3, about, you know, heard that he lost his nose and it's not all that bad. That was a way for Dave and Dan to say, yeah, book readers, get a hold of yourselves. We're not going to make Tyrion wear some kind of blue thing over his nose so that we can CGI every single scene that he's in. Sorry, not going to happen. In the same way, Maggie the Frog in the books is described as this haggard old woman and everything. And so they got this really enigmatic and great actress to play this role. And so naturally the line is, Cersei, young Cersei says, well, you're not nearly as scary as they say. And that's to tell us book readers, yeah, chill out. It's okay. It's okay that our Maggie the Frog is different than yours. It's okay. I love that. But that's not even the point here. I'm in the question section. I'm supposed to be asking a question, right? Well, the witch flashback, she needs a taste of blood in order to be able to tell the future. And I asked Susan if she considered this blood magic. I wish we still had that recording. I wish it hadn't gone to the wayside to the point where I couldn't at least paste some of her stuff in. But it's just, I totally wrecked that file somehow. Anyway, I asked Susan if she thought, because she needs to taste the blood, if this is considered a form of blood magic. And is blood magic the most powerful magic that we have in this universe of Westeros and Essos and Southeros and whatever other Oses there are out there? And she said yes to both things. And I agree with her that this is some type of blood magic. But I want to ask you, do you find it to be blood magic as well? And also, is the fact that she predicts that 3 children will be born, that a future queen, younger, prettier, will replace her, is this further proof of a deterministic universe? I've often stood on that platform that this universe is deterministic, that when people see things in the future, they are seeing stuff that is going to actually happen, even if it's just in a metaphoric sense. For instance, Danny meeting Khal Drogo and Rhaego out in the north when she was having her House of the Undying vision. Does that mean that she's going to die somewhere in the north? Meet, you know, be rejoined with Drogo and with Rhaego. We'll have to see, of course, with that. But that's the kind of deterministic universe that I'm talking about. And Cersei, we know now, on a rewatch, she does have 3 children. All of them are blonde. All of them do die. But that makes you ask the question about some of these other pregnancies that Cersei allegedly had. Cersei tells Catelyn in, I think, the 2nd episode of season 2, or season 1, pardon me, the very 2nd episode, that, you know, she and Robert had a boy, but it didn't live very long. And that Robert was pounding holes in the wall to, you know, out of his grief. Was Cersei telling the truth about that? Because if she was, then that would seem to make this witch's prediction untrue. Now, granted, the baby did die, but it almost makes it sound like the baby lived for at least a half a second, the way Cersei tells the story. So that would make this prediction untrue. So does that wreck the whole deterministic universe philosophy that I have? And then, of course, Cersei has this latest pregnancy. Let me go back and just say, Cersei could have been lying about this baby, because there's no way that Catelyn's going, if she hears that he was putting his fist through stone walls over this, then she's not going to bring it up to Robert, right? So Cersei knows that this isn't something she's going to be questioned about. Maybe she's just trying to relate to Catelyn in some way or another. Or maybe she's just trying to relay about her concern for her own children as a result of this prophecy that she got when she was younger. But there is a possibility that Cersei's lying about that pregnancy. There's also a possibility that Cersei could be lying about the pregnancy now. Or that the pregnancy will end without the birth of a live child. That's possible too. But that's the only two possibilities on either of these outside pregnancies, outside of the three kids, that this remains a deterministic universe. If this witch's prediction is part of a deterministic universe, then Cersei, if she has this child that she's allegedly pregnant with in season 7, that breaks that. And that means that anything's possible. That means that the future is possible again. So those are some interesting questions to ponder about that. Another question that I had was about Melisandre. She tells Jon that she's never cold. And Jon puts his hand on her and feels that she's quite warm. And I was always wondering if that was because, I mean, there are some clues in the books that might give us some kind of idea about that. I don't know how much stock I put in any of that. But we do know that Melisandre is wearing a glamour as of the first episode of season 6. We know that once she takes that necklace off, she's not who she appears to be. Or at least she's not the age that she appears to be. She may have looked that way when she was younger. Who knows? But she doesn't look that way now in reality. Correct? So is her warmth actually a result of that, what we call a glamour, something that makes her appear different? Is that a result of the glamour, her warmth? Is it something about the magic of that necklace that just makes her warm all the time? Or is there something warm actually within her all of the time? A question we'll probably never get an answer to, nor do we need to get an answer to, really, but, you know, it's still fun to talk about. The last thing, and it's a question that we have not got an answer to yet, and I don't know that we ever will, is about Tyrion and Varys while they're at Illyrio's place. Now, if you remember who Illyrio is, he was the guy who was harboring Viserys and Daenerys in the very first episode of Game of Thrones. He arranged the marriage with Drogo and all of that stuff. So they're at his place, so to speak. But when Varys, I'm going to get these names mixed up a lot this episode, when Varys tells Tyrion about the fact that there was a small group, a quote, small group, who wanted to restore the Targaryen name. And that's essentially Illyrio telling Viserys that there's these, you know, that the people will flock to him once he comes to Westeros. Way back in episode 1, the very first episode. However, who is this small group that Varys talks about other than himself? Who would it be? I mean, Barristan Selmy came to Daenerys' side, but that was basically because Joffrey dismissed him. And he's the only other person that I've seen from Westeros that really welcomes Daenerys as a leader. And of course, he's gone now at the end of this season, actually in just a couple of episodes coming up. So who is this small group of people? And where are they now that Dany is on Westeros in season 7? Were they ever there? Why would Varys lie to Tyrion about that? Who are they? And these are kind of like the questions that, like, we'll never get an answer to, right? And it's even pointless to ask, but I love asking them. For a long time when I was podcasting about Lost, my buddies from the what podcast network is it? The DVR podcast network. Sorry. Took me a second for it to come back to me. Cause I get them and, Bubba's Double P Media mixed up sometimes, but like, Axel and Donald and probably Tim and I know Heath, they were all making fun of me. They used to call it Matt's Tomatoes. Cause I wondered where tomatoes came from on the island. All of a sudden in season, I guess it was season 6 of Lost. I was like, well, where'd the tomatoes come from? We never had tomatoes before. Where'd they find the tomatoes? Yeah, it was a stupid question. And I ask a lot of stupid questions. So these may be to Matt's Tomatoes questions to you too. And that's fine. But if you have answers to any of these questions or opinions about them, then feel free to email me, mattsaudioblog@gmail.com, mattsaudioblog@gmail.com, or you can tweet to mattsgotblog on Twitter. On to tidbits.
Tidbits.
And my tidbit here is about Stannis, because he seems so secure right now. But we know that he's going to, once again, just like he was in most of season 4, he's going to seem very desperate. He was extremely desperate with Davos, like breaking even his little map pieces. He's breaking his toys. He was so desperate when Davos didn't have any men for him. And then Davos comes up with the idea of going to the Iron Bank and blah, blah, blah. And now he's got all these men. But he seems settled and secure. Even when he's talking to Mance Rayder, he seems almost nice. It's like, just bend the knee, man. I'll be kind. I will. I promise you. All you have to do is bend the knee. And of course, Mance won't. And then he ends up burning him. But we're going to see that desperation in Stannis yet again. And we've seen that desperation in Stannis for quite some time. Stannis is not a good guy, people. He's not. I know that there's something that's almost kind of likable about him. I'll tell you what was likable about Stannis is at the end of the season, and we'll talk about it then, at the Battle of Winterfell, when he sucks it up and says, yeah, I messed up. At least he does do that. But the road to get there, all this stuff that's coming up with Shireen, I mean, that's desperate if you're willing to sacrifice your own daughter. It's horrible. Absolutely horrible. And I probably didn't talk nearly as much about most of the episode that you would like me to, but I don't know, we're in a rewatch, and the further we get along in the rewatch, the harder and harder it is going to be to come up with things that will relate to future episodes. We need to look more, at how characters culminate, how they reach their own climactic run, perhaps, because the story is going to start eliminating these characters at a darn quick rate, which is unfortunate, but that's the way it goes. All right, so that is it for my discussion of the story of the episode. We do have two other story segments left. There are three words where we describe the episode in three words, and the brothel mates, the best coupling of the episode, those are next.
Three words, describing the episode in three words.
All right, thank you, Bubba. That's Bubba from the Joffrey of Podcasts, which is available on the Double P Media Network, I guess is what you call that. You can follow them at Double P HQ. That's the word double, the letter P, and HQ. So thanks, Bubba, for doing the voiceovers. Also thanks to Axel Foley from the DVR Podcast Network for doing all of the voiceovers for Podcast Winterfell for years, and I even used some of them here for a while, so thanks, Axel. Check both those medias out. They're pretty awesome. They got lots of different podcasts for lots of different shows. Anyway, this is where you try to describe the episode in three words, and it's not always an easy thing to do. Trying to find something that encompasses the whole episode can be pretty hard. Sometimes you just have to choose a section of the episode and try and describe that in three words, or maybe a quote, or maybe a favorite action or something like that. I accept all of those. If you get yours in to me regarding any season 5 episode, your three word description, I will include it in the next feedback podcast for certain. You have until January 19th of 2019 to get those into me. So be thinking about that for this episode and any of the future episodes, and get them into me. And we'll have fun with this segment during our feedback podcast as well. My three words this time around: Cersei's secret motivations. To me, this flashback tells a lot of Cersei's story. And not necessarily justifying anything that she's done. She's done a lot of terrible things. She will continue to do a lot of terrible things. And there's no justification for this. But at least we find the reasoning behind it. And that's a big deal to me. I also feel like it kind of explains why when Ned went away, it was probably good for her. She probably didn't mind so much that Joffrey more or less tore up Ned, because Ned had given her a chance to get away with her children, and she had basically said no to that. And so Ned was a threat, and she had to make sure that she got rid of Ned. And even though she says she was horrified by what Joffrey did, yeah, I mean, that way all of her children are still safe and at the throne. But then Tyrion comes along, and he sends Marcella away, and you can see why she was terribly upset about that. And of course, we see as this season goes on why she will really be terribly upset about that. And finally, the youngest child, Tommen, he's going to become the tug of rope between the queen that was younger, right, Margaery, who she perceives to be the queen that was younger, even though I think you could make a case for the fact that it might be Daenerys. Some people in the books even think it still might be Sansa someday. So there you go. Either way, a younger, prettier queen, you know, she starts this tug of war with her and Tommen that will ultimately end in, well, the end of House Tyrell in a lot of ways, and the end of her line in a lot of ways, outside of this whatever pregnancy this is that would be in total violation of said prophecy, if it comes true. Or at least it would make that prophecy not relevant and wrong, which is possible. To me, it has bigger implications because it means the deterministic universe model is gone. So, those are my three words. What would yours be for this particular episode? Also, please take a look in the show notes and list, and just look at the musicians who are creating the music for you. Starting in episode 3, we're going to have a new theme being played sometimes with a group of people from looperman.com who contributed loops for me to put together and to then orchestrate other stuff on top of. So it's important to me, not that you buy anybody's stuff, I'm not trying to sell anything here. It's just important to me that you know who the people are that are creating music for you, if you're listening to this on a podcast app. If you're listening on YouTube, this section of the podcast doesn't have music on it, like it does on the podcast app that you use, like in iTunes or what have you. That's because the rules are slightly different. YouTube just decides that I'm not worthy of playing a certain piece of music, even if I have a piece of paper in my hand from John Pizzarelli telling me that I do. That's okay. I don't want to fight YouTube, so you don't get any music during the YouTube version, but you do during the podcast app version. So look at those show notes, acknowledge the music that's being created, and I'll be back with the best coupling of the episode. That's the Brothelmates. That's next.
Brothelmates, the best coupling of the episode.
Brothelmates is the best coupling. Does not necessarily have to be two people. It can be a person and a concept, or a person and an object, or something like that. My brothelmates this time around, Brienne and Podrick. And no, of course not in a romantic way, but Pod just sticking by her. It's the best example of what a squire is supposed to be to a knight, right? It's the relationship of what that is supposed to be. It's a complete representation, I guess I should say, of what that relationship is supposed to be. Even though Brienne is not a knight, and really Podrick is not really a squire, it's still just it's a wonderful relationship that they have, and he'll stick with her through thick and thin as she fights windmill after windmill until their lives finally find meaning once they finally do rescue Sansa at the beginning of season 6. And that's my brothel mates. What would yours be? Maybe you have a different pairing. Maybe you liked Varys and Tyrion's talk, or maybe you just like Cersei and her secret motivations. Maybe that's a best coupling. Whatever you like. That's it for the brothel mates, and that's it for the story section. We get into the section that most people like what I do most in terms of what they feel that I really know what I'm talking about, and that is the musical analysis, where we're this time around, we're looking at some edgier or deceptive versions of themes that we already know.
The music on Game of Thrones.
Three questions you get. You unlike the answers.
I've been promised to the prince.
So that clip from when we see Cersei's childhood flashback, but really long before we had any indication of who Cersei was in terms of how the dialogue might tip it, Ramin was tipping the answer to us in the music. It was slightly skewed, admittedly, but essentially what we heard was a bit of the Reigns of Castamere playing. However, he did alter the melody just a little bit to make it sound more creepy. Instead of the usual melodic notes, he actually replaced one note to make it sound more creepy like this. But then in the scene with Jaime, he returned to the main theme of Castamere, but he still used the same pedal point. Now, what is a pedal point, you ask? Well, a pedal point is the lowest note that is held out against any melodic or harmonic elements. So it doesn't matter whether a melody is playing something that would go against that bottom note, or if the harmony changes against that bottom note stays the same. And that's what we call a pedal point. And Ramin actually chose to use the exact same pedal point in the Jaime and Cersei scene to help us make the connection musically to the earlier scene with Cersei and the witch.
He never wanted you to be a king's guard, but here you are, protecting his dead body.
What he built.
All of these things help add edge to compositions that we're already familiar with. In the Cersei flashback, Ramin altered the melody. In the next example from this episode, Ramin's going to use harmony to make things edgier. We have Dany coming to see Viserion and Rhaegal, and we will hear the theme that we associate with her dragon connection. But listen to the clip and try and figure out what gives this rendition of the theme a little more edge, and then I'll explain afterwards.
Easy, easy.
The difference, to make things edgier this time, as I said, is harmony. The last phrase is left hanging by a chord that doesn't normally resolve to the home key, like this. Now compare that to where we normally are used to hearing the harmony resolve to. And again, it's really just the difference of one note, but it makes a tremendous psychological difference for the listener. Now, we've explored how melody and harmony can add edge to a familiar theme, and there is one other way. We're all familiar with the wall theme, right? But listen to the timbre. That's the instrument that's making the melody in this next clip as Mance Rayder is being presented to Stannis to either bend the knee or die. The sound is different than anything we've heard used for that particular melody before. It almost kind of sounds like some kind of like muted pipe organ sound. And that's far different from the horn sound or the synth sounds that we're used to in terms of the wall theme. It does make us perk up and pay a little bit of attention because the sound is different, even though the melody is familiar. That one just really got my attention because the timbre, the sound of the instrument, changed the meaning of the theme for this particular instance. Having a pipe organ sound almost made it seem more like a funeral march, which is essentially what it was, right? But let's move on to the last theme that was made edgier in this episode, and it was done so twice, thanks to, I guess, yet another technique, really. And that technique is development. If you've taken any kind of musical humanities class, then you know that we composers can never just leave a theme alone. No, no, no. Even as far back as Mendelssohn or Bach, or as long as composers have been composing, themes that we create have to be developed because we just can't leave them alone. They have to be expanded upon, either melodically or harmonically or rhythmically. Because, you know, we composers, we're pretty much a bunch of people who can't let go of a theme. Mozart, Beethoven, every great piece of music has had a statement of a theme followed by the development or expansion of that theme, either through harmonic development or melodic development. And in this particular case, when John is atop the wall talking to Stannis, Ramin decides to stretch his musical legs regarding the Lord of Light theme. And he adds a little bit to it. He develops it like this.
Your Grace, you want the wildlings to march in your army?
They swear to follow me, I'll pardon them. take Winterfell once the North is...
Now, naturally, you heard the melody. But then you also heard additional chords and this strange sense that the theme was trying to go, I don't know, kind of like somewhere else, right? And boy, does it. Oh, man. In this final scene where Melisandre sets fire to the pyre, that's hard to say, the melody is present. But then things evolve to tell the story of Mance's plight while still at the same time keeping you connected to the theme. It's the perfect example of developing a theme beyond its original premise. It makes it emotional. It tells a story of how wrong this is. And yet you never really stop hearing the theme itself, the Lord of Light theme, in your head, even when everything is going completely different. It's there's things going on all around that theme that aren't part of the theme, but still now feel like they should be part of the theme. And that's the clip I'm going to leave you with. And enjoy, I think, one of Ramin's greater achievements in this particular season especially. And I'll be back with some closing thoughts in just a moment.
Free folk, there is only one true king. And his name is Stannis. Here stands your king of lies. Behold the fate of those who choose the darkness.
Hope you enjoyed the musical analysis. Hope you enjoyed the podcast. Thanks for sticking with me. Tell a friend about the podcast, if you will. And if you haven't left me a written review on whatever podcast app that you use and you're capable of, I do understand that some podcast apps won't let you do it, but some podcast apps will. And if you're subscribed to any of those, please leave me a written review. It's the only way that people are going to notice this podcast. And I would love to have a lot of people talking about what's going on with season 8 by the time we get there. And time's running out. Wow. Just around the corner, 2019 is. And April of 2019 is just around the corner from that. It's going to be lots of fun. This particular season of podcasts, I've got lots of guests coming up. Again, I was supposed to have two guests for this particular podcast. Didn't work out that way. But I can guarantee you, you will get Kelly for episodes 2, 3, and 4. I can guarantee you that you will get Susan for episode 3. And probably episode 9. And I can guarantee that you will get Stephanie, for episode 5 and episode 10 of this season. And I can guarantee that you will get Holly for episode 7 and 8, I believe. And we get Bubba for episodes 5 and 8 as well. So there's a lot of fun from people much smarter than me coming up in future episodes. Thanks for sticking with us. We'll see you on Thursday. Bye.
You've been listening to Matt's audio blog. Find all contact information, back episodes, and podcast app links at mattsaudioblog.com.